Hello and welcome everyone to this Pyramid Analytics webinar with our partners CCW Learning Consultants, Alex Castello-Cortez and Georgina Webster. Welcome Alex and George.
Hi.
Hi, morning.
Right. I'm Kate Tickner and I'm delighted to be here today with CCW. They specialise in supporting retail trading teams to succeed via tailored enablement programmes and IT delivery support. Our webinar today is on the theme of revolutionising retail by empowering retailers with decision intelligence. So let's get started. Are you ready?
Yeah, we are all ready to go.
Excellent. Yes. Okay, well, let's start with you, Alex. What are the biggest issues for retailers in relation to, say, data and analytics that you see?
That's a really great question. And I see three challenges, if I'm honest. The first one around legacy data estates, you know, because, you know, some company retailers have quite complex data sources, and, you know, gathering all together, it can be quite a complex gathering of data together, and that therefore leads to quite poor performance sometimes, and duplication of data, and perhaps a lack of trust in that data. I think the second answer, part of that answer, is all about the width and depth of the actual data available. And if you just think about a retailer, for instance, you know, a retailer can have 1,000 SKUs, 10,000 SKUs, 100,000 SKUs. So you've got all those products, and then each one of those products will on their own probably have up to 200 attributes per product. And that's been quite conservative. So that's just the products that you're dealing with a retailer. You add into that customer information, and then marketing information, supply chain information, finance, etc. And suddenly you have this huge amount of information that needs to be gathered really into one place and then streamlined so that that information becomes really quite accurate and relevant. And that can be quite costly and quite difficult to do. And I think the third part of this question comes around the speed and the accuracy of the data. So it needs to be really quickly accessible to all users to make decisions on the go. And then even more importantly, that data needs to be up to date. So, you know, as retailers, sometimes we work on reports that have been issued on a Monday and we're still looking at them during the week. You know, that's not something that can really hold water anymore. So those are the challenges I see.
Okay. And so if I'm listening and hearing you correctly, you were talking about the fact that they've got a lot of legacy data systems as well as new ones that they want to bring in to meet new regulations or new business needs. They've got the data there's not only a lot of data in terms of things like SKUs, so that's, you know, the depth of the data, but it's also a very broad data set, so you might have lots and lots of product information, and then again perhaps the need of modern business, it needs to be much faster, but also due to things like regulation, perhaps the reliability and the accuracy has to be much better than perhaps they could have got away with in the past. Is that a reasonable summary?
I think that's exact.
Okay. All right. Well, so George, we've established that there's a lot of data, and presumably also there have been a plethora of different tools to deal with that, the old ones and then the new ones. But I think increasingly, you know, the reason why we talk about things like decision intelligence is that there's this huge demand for better insight. So how does that complicate? How does that complicate things even more, shall we say?
Well, it's interesting because as Alex has mentioned, with all of this data, with all of these systems, and we were talking about this the other day, and we could name sort of 10 different systems off the top of our head, and that's just ones that we were kind of just thinking of straight away. There is so much data there. There's so many pieces of information to have to bring together, and transferring this data, that often happens, it comes through to a third party for analysis. Often that's a spreadsheet. You know, we know retail love Excel, it has to be said. So they're bringing in all of this data, transferring it all in, and it complicates things because with all of that different data coming in at different times, at different points, it just means that sometimes it's not quite as good as it could be. And actually then you have a lack of trust in that data. You have a lack of, you know, it's not from the original sort of data banks, it's not from the original status, you're bringing that all in, it's a lack of trust of it, a lack of knowledge of what that information is telling you. And then of course it all just becomes a little bit cloudy and a little bit muddy and you don't really know what's going on with it. So it gets really complicated when people are looking for like the right answers and where to find them.
Okay, well you're now in the position where you're providing services to retailers, but previously you were in fact in retail yourselves for quite some years. And you know, on that topic, I mean, heaven forbid, but perhaps there might also be, you know, customizations of the data. Someone might have either themselves or brought in a third party to perhaps customize systems or data. I mean, does that ever happen, perhaps?
Absolutely. I mean, when we were looking at some of the systems that were being used and, you know, things would be built on because somebody uses one part of data and then somebody else doesn't. And then the data doesn't talk to each other. It's sort of, oh, why doesn't that work? Well, because everybody's brought in their own little bits.
And sometimes they aren't even people that are part of the organisation. Yeah, and then they've left or whatever. OK, well, look, I hate to bring up a dirty word, but you mentioned that the spreadsheet, the S word there, you know, the spreadsheet word. Why can't they just carry on using spreadsheets, George? What's the problem there? Why not just carry on as they've always done? What's the issue?
There absolutely is a place for spreadsheets. You know, it's we appreciate that. People do use them. There are small businesses where this is the way they work, and so there is absolutely a place for that. But the problem is with having spreadsheets, and what we've encountered is that with so much information going in there and so many people using and creating their own spreadsheets, there's not really any governance of it. There's not really any one true owner of any piece of information. And it becomes a little bit complex because, you know, one person's created one report the way they want it. Somebody else has created something else the way they want it. With that, there's also no control over it. You know, so many people creating so much. It's spreadsheet hell because there's just so much, hundreds of them floating around. No governance, no control. No tracking of what versions are true. You know, there's so many versions of the truth there. And of course, within all of this then, because there are those data, different versions, and as Alex said, you know, things get changed. We might be looking at something that's been created on a Monday and we're looking at it on Thursday. So it's out of date. Even when you look at it on a Tuesday, it's out of date. So the data's not up to scratch. It's not all there for them. And then finally, the last bit is there's a real assumption that everybody knows how to use a spreadsheet, how to create something, how to do VLOOKUPs and pivot tables and all sorts of complex calculations. And actually, the truth is that they really don't. You know, some people do have that expertise. They do have that knowledge. And some people are really excited about, you know, creating their own spreadsheets. But actually, in other cases, it that knowledge isn't there. And that can lead to some real big mistakes. I think we've probably seen things in the news where wrong people have been put forward for elections because the spreadsheet wasn't correct. Yeah. You know, misinterpreting information or the wrong sum or missing a zero off or changing something or even just hiding a field. So there is a real lack of knowledge, a lack of understanding in the data that's sort of out there and available. So, you know, can have real huge cost implications to a business.
Well, and I think that's a critical point here, because people talk about governance and then other people's eyes start to glaze over slightly. And then, oh, the rules and you have to do this. But I think it's very important to link the governance thing to actual tangible outcomes. And I think your point there about the money loss or reputational loss or election loss is very important. And I think that following that trail from, oh, the data's bad, right through to the outcomes or it impacts people. Have you got any examples of that that you can share? It doesn't have anonymous ones. I mean, have you seen where a lack of governance can actually cause outcomes like that? Have you got any examples?
Oh, Ali,
that's a good one. I mean, I think that sometimes when you relate, when you've got a spreadsheet going and you then have quite a complex spreadsheet and you're linking it to a completely separate spreadsheet somewhere else, and the person that has filled in spreadsheet B does not realize that this information is being picked up by spreadsheet A, and they remove a bit of, you know, a bit of formula, then suddenly, you know, you've, you know, a range plan is a great example where you might have something very big or that's talking to different web, different spreadsheets. So yes, I think there are examples where in every business where there are
and examples of errors. I can think of something as well where there was an example about a pricing situation where someone had misread a price and then changed price of an item. And of course, then, you know, the price has gone down when it really shouldn't have. And of course, that cost, you know, can cost quite a lot there.
Yeah, so different. I assume this rolls right up to the sort of board level, where if you've got C-level KPIs and the data can't be relied upon, then they'll be making decisions for the broader health of the business based on inaccurate information.
Yeah.
All sorts of things can happen. Okay, so let's talk about, you talked there, George, about some people being more or less, I'm not going to say competent in terms of their jobs as retailers, but in terms of technical things like Excel or other analytics packages. And I'll stick my hand in the air, I'm not the most, you know, tech savvy person when it comes to analytics, but, you know, Alex, let's take that thread a bit further. I mean, what would be the benefits of making analytics accessible to more end users, like people who actually have the domain expertise in retail?
Well, I just think, I think this is such an exciting development, I think, to make analytics open to so many more areas within retail. And I think, you know, all levels of organization now sort of, you know, all different roles need access to data. And it's almost like data on the go, isn't it? It's almost like I'm doing my job and I kind of need the information now. I can't afford to go and ask somebody for it. Or I can't afford to wait for it to come. I need it now. And I think that's what's so exciting, is that it's open to everybody at every role now. That accessibility is great. You know, the old days where, in the past where perhaps, you know, reporting was in the control of the very few. And if you wanted a report, you had to go and ask for it. If you wanted it customized, you had to go and ask for it. Well, suddenly I think that's gone and it's going. And I think suddenly that small group of people now have the freedom to do the job they wanted to do and do something much more worthwhile. And the people who wanted that access suddenly have the accessibility and the empowerment, I think, to actually access that data and do that research themselves. You know, I think it takes away the fear of analytics, because suddenly it's much more accessible. And you've got things like AI where you can put a chat and go, you know, so these are my sales for the week, but what from this, what products are driving my sales? And it comes back and it tells you. And you can take that one step further if you want to and go, well, okay, so these are the products driving my sales, but that's great, but does that match my forecast and do I have enough stock? And if not, what do we do? So I think the accessibility from the very tech to those that are less technical, the ability and the functionality, I think is huge. I really do. I think the gains are enormous, both for the individual and for the company, both looking at the same set of data with the same goals.
Okay, so tying that back to this idea of, you know, perhaps governed self-service, idea that you can collaborate within the same environment on the same data sets, but you can enable a level of freedom and in an environment that's kind of no code or low code, powered by, as you say, AI guided things, so chatbots or explain functionality, or even, you know, linking to things like ChatGPT that can allow people to go and look something up and bring that into the same environment. But ultimately, they're all operating within the same set of data. So it's being, there's a trail, let's say, a lineage. Okay. And so, I mean, let's talk then. The next step is, well, okay, you've got all that stuff, this technical stuff, it's easier to use, it's governed, but there are, based on your experience, both of you, perhaps starting with Alex, and in which retail areas do you see the best opportunities for some quick wins? Because we all know that people's attention can wane sometimes, and that, you know, people want to see a quick win. And so where do you see those in terms of the potential benefits of decision intelligence for this idea of revolutionising retail?
I think it's almost there are so many areas, Kate, that you just look at and think, oh, that'd be so exciting. You can do this and you can do that, and it's almost cherry picking the right one. But if forced to choose, and I did have a really long list when I started this morning, and I've had to whittle it down, and I'm still not sure I've chosen the right one. But I think for me would be almost the piece around price optimization. I think for me that is really something that is quite exciting. That ability to maximize your margin and realizing you don't have to have the same price strategy for every single product. I mean, you can really dig down and choose, look at how to really maximize pricing by category, by location, by customer, by store. And I think that's quite exciting for me. I think that sort of the ability to make scenarios and learn and gather information, I think there's a lot to be had for pricing, because it's absolutely crucial to maximize your margins in retail. I mean, that's just got to make your prices work.
Okay, and George, what's your pick?
Well, I would say, about because my background is merchandising, so I'm all about the numbers in terms of the forecasting and the prediction of sales and that sort of thing. So I think for me it's all about being able to make sure your stock is in the right place at the right time, and being able to predict that kind of that sales profile there, you know, looking at spending habits, looking at how people are buying, you know, what locations are selling what, things like understanding your channels and who's, you know, how much stock you might be selling online. But actually, on the sort of flip side of things like that, if you're selling something of a particular range online and you're seeing lots of those pieces being returned back to a certain branch, is it because your demographic in that area actually need to stock that item and they don't? And you know, it's actually using that data to make decisions about where your stock is going to be, who's going to benefit the most, who's going to be able to kind of do the most for you by having the right amount of stock in the right place at the right time.
Okay, so another question springs to mind then, really. I think it's fair to say that, you know, when we are out talking to customers across all sorts of different industries, we have a set of people and job titles that perhaps are the consumers or the viewers of information. And then we have a set of people or job titles that are the ones who perhaps create the reports and disseminate them for broader consumption, or, you know, if there are queries that the end users can't do themselves for any reason, then they go back to them. So in retail terms, as far as titles and departments and things like that, who do you think are going to be the people that create the reports, the decision intelligence, and then who are the sorts of people that are going to benefit from viewing the output and being able to manipulate that output and having that level of self-service?
I think that I think it's a good question. I think the title has changed with an organization, but ultimately, you know, it is, you know, I think going forward, you know, reporting very much used to be with the IT department, and I think that will change very much to be more a data analytic role now, and a data team. I think lots of retailers now have their data teams, but I would be surprised if merchandising still didn't have the power to create reports within there too. But that could then be shared with, you know, the trading strategy teams and, you know, and buying teams and product information teams. So I think you might get the same users along with data analysts, but I think the availability and the interaction of other groups, you know, would be wide as well.
Anything from your side, George?
Yeah, I think that, again, as Alex has said, you know, you're going to have those the sort of merchandising teams and the data analysts creating the sort of basis reports. But I see that the consumers of those reports is very far reaching, and even to the point that, you know, it's great to have that knowledge on the shop floor of, you know, what are my best sellers? Why are they my best sellers? Are they in the right place? Can I move those to the front of the shop? You know, and actually, and it goes back to that empowerment side of things and making those decisions to actually optimize your sales profile. And so you can start off with the really high level reports by the merchandisers buying the product and creating the orders, but then rolling it down to everybody's usage
That's available on mobiles or handheld devices and iPads. Yeah, okay. And then just taking that one step further, we've talked so far about making all of that available to consumers, obviously via a web browser, so anyone can get in inside an organisation. What about external users? I mean, who are the people that retailers have to think about when presenting information to people outside of their organisations? We touched on this the other day, and I think you were talking about perhaps groups within bigger groups, but you know, where you've got a group of companies within a larger umbrella. So that's one example perhaps to think about and talk about. But what about external bodies and regulators or other suppliers? And what do you see as the potential for that?
Both pausing. But I absolutely, I think that, you know, the fact that, you know, all this data can be shared is great. So you can share it with, you know, your suppliers. You can also get information from them, so it becomes a shared functionality on tracking the whole supply chain through. Yep. I think that would be great. And I think you've probably got the wider sort of brands, and which I think they're always out there as well. And I just think of other pieces. So if you have an organization that has more than one stream in it, so, you know, you might want to share it with your sister company as well, backwards like that.
Okay, we lost Alex's signal just there.
Sorry, apologies.
I was just going to jump in and say, when you were talking about the brands, because there are so many retailers, you know, maybe a big department store that are buying directly from brands and having those concessions in there. And it's great to be able to share that information backwards and forwards between them to, you know, how well they're doing, what do we need to replace, what do we need to sort of move on. So sharing that info back and forward is going to be brilliant.
Definitely. And, you know, perhaps being able to decide whether, you know, in a particular location for a particular social demographic group, they send some, you know, one set of stock to that store, but they don't send the identical set to a different one. But being able to decide that perhaps in more of a real time basis so that the deliveries can be as up to date as possible. And I suppose it's an endless list of, you know, what might be possible if you can give people access. And then I'm guessing as well, there might be opportunities to maybe monetize the data in some way, if they're able to bring it together and make it available externally. But I'm not a retail expert, but would there be chances to do that, do you think? Sell, you know, put together consolidated views of data that might other people might be interested in, perhaps.
Yeah, I think so. And, you know, you know, sort of market information and insight information that we share, you know, with looking at sort of trends, etc., within a fashion, for instance, you know, yes, that you can definitely share that kind of information across. And I think it, you know, you can share it within the industry and a wider circle.
Right. Okay. Well, it's been fascinating talking to you. I can feel the revolution starting to take place already. Thanks so much for your insights and views and for being a pyramid partner. And we're really looking forward to doing more work with you in the future. Thanks very much.
Thank you. It's been great talking to you.
No problem.